Hello everybody, welcome back to the workshop. So in this video, I want to have a quick discussion about how to properly tune in your air-assisted treadle hammer when you get it. And I also want to take and debunk a couple myths about it and things like that that I've seen here recently through some comment threads and various blacksmith forums. So first and foremost, let's just go with the tuning up. For those who want to take and see how to do that first, and then I'll get into kind of debunking a few things here about the treadle hammer. So first things first, how do we set this up for our anvil height? The anvil height that you will have will vary greatly depending on your inseam height. If you want to know what your, if you know what your inseam height is, that's roughly about what an anvil's height should be for you to work comfortably at it. Now, that's not always the case. Some people have longer arms, some people have shorter arms, so you'll just have to adjust it accordingly that fits about right for you. Now, generally, that is just a standard anvil height around your shop for all your anvils, so you'll want to set this treadle hammer up similarly. Now, let's say you want to set it up to where you can sit down at it, or if you have to be physically impaired and you're using this and you have to use it from a wheelchair and or from a seated position, then you set up the anvil at a comfortable height first. So that's first and foremost. So that means there's going to be a lot of variability. Now, when I did a build video for all of my customers who have purchased this air-assisted treadle hammer kit from me, over at our website, blacksmithingblanks.com. The link for that will be down in the description down below. I gave general measurements of my setup that work in my shop. Now, that means my anvil is going to be different than probably what you're working with. So you need to set up, first and foremost, the hammer to the correct height to begin with, and that is all relayed around this bracket right here. That's this middle bracket that you see here. That is the very first step of setting up the correct height of the hammer. So ideally, you'll have the hammer in its middle position on this back adjusting plate. And then without anything being drilled or bolted through here just yet, you're going to set the hammer head on your anvil height, because that's what will determine your treadle hammer height. You'll set it there to where it is level across. And then you are going to pick up on the back to where the hammer is hitting slightly toe heavy when it comes to that. So you're going to lift it up slightly. So this way it's at a bit of an angle to where the hammer is rocking up kind of toe heavy, like as if you were standing on that side of the anvil drawing a piece out. So that is the correct position for you to originally set up the hammer. The reason for this being is once we put on the spring and everything, when the hammer comes all the way down, we need there to be a small gap that sits there that provides that extra little bit of crack or a little bit of whip at the end of the hammer stroke. So it's always good to set that up to where it's just a little bit toe heavy. Once that's done, we've drilled holes and we've bolted this thing together. Next thing, let's take a look at how the hammer actually operates. The hammer actually operates via a spring and an air cylinder. If you have the air assist, you will use the air assist in, or your foot. You can use your foot like this, or you can actually use the air assist pedal, which is over here. Okay. You can use either or, the air cylinder or your foot. All that air cylinder does is provide a pull stroke. It is pulling the hammer down to meet the surface of the anvil or your steel or your top tooling. The spring, however, is what returns the hammer back up to its original starting position. Why is this important to understand the dynamics here? The reason why this is important is the length of this spring will be critical for the performance or the whip of this hammer. So think of it in a way of this is a hybrid hammer between a air power hammer that would be all air cylinder, so that's air powered up, air powered down, and a, you know, like a spring hammer or something of like a helve hammer where you have a spring and you get a whip to it. So when we're using this hammer, if we just put our foot all the way down and we just do this, we're gonna get little blows like so. We're gonna get very tiny little blows. But if we press this down and we let it up and then go down with it, now we get a whip to it and this thing hits just as hard and arguably can hit harder than even a striker striking for the fences on this, depending on the size hammerhead and how you have things set up. So the spring tension matters. That's why we have provided and included an adjustment chain. Instead of this being a fixed focal point, we have provided an adjustment chain that has multiple links to it. So don't be afraid to take this bracket and set it up here if you need to, within reason, for your adjustment chain, because you can go all the way clear out to here and have that spring hooked up to it, okay? So that adjustment chain is there to provide fine-tune adjustment of raising the height of the hammerhead or lowering the height of the hammerhead depending on your personal situation. You may want the hammerhead to be down a little bit more so it's a little more toe heavy, so it's kind of draws out your work a little bit quicker or provides it taper there on the end. Or you may want to have it up a little higher because you're using some short tooling or you're forging down some larger material and you want the hammerhead to come down and hit square. So this spring tension is really important because it is what pulls this hammerhead back up into the air for the next blow. That being said, if you're using the air cylinder or if you're using the foot treadle itself, you need to provide the whip of a mechanical hammer if you want to get the full power of the stroke out. So same thing with the air assist. If you just step on this, it's going to stay down. If you don't allow this to go back up, it's going to stay down on you and you're not going to get a lot of hitting energy. As you can see, the spring is always stretched out here. I can hit very hard if I tap on the pedal at the top end of the stroke. So when this returns that spring all the way back up, and then I suddenly smack that pedal again, I get a full hard stroke out of the hammerhead itself. So again, that is a very critical thing, and you will need to adjust that until it sounds like you're really thumping that anvil good and hard to get the maximum out of it. So that'll bring into the next adjustment point. A lot of things come up online about swing arm treadle hammers, how they are worse than inline treadle hammers. And I have overcome the difficulties of a swing arm treadle hammer, and most swing arm treadle hammers have overcome their own difficulties long before me, before my design here, and that is simply by adjusting the fulcrum point, the point at the back and its height in relation to your hitting surface. That is what the three holes are provided for on the bracket. You can position this in any of the three holes that you would like. There is also three holes on the air cylinder bracket, so you can adjust it accordingly. And then that's why there is all the adjustment links on the chain, on the foot treadle, on the upper portion. There's all this adjustment for variability to suit your needs on a particular given day or time. And that's the gloriousness of this hammer right here. So I hope that will help you get your hammer set up properly. I know that some of the measurements are quite nuanced. So let me give you one measurement so you guys can see about the gap between the hammer and the anvil head here as I have it set up in my shop. For those of you who have purchased these hammers, I thank you guys so much, and you already know most of these measurements. I'm just going to give you a dimension that we're shooting for. So the height of this hammer is 12 inches of clearance, or 12 inches of throw in between the face of the anvil and the hammer head. If you're got a bug in my mouth there, if your hammer is down like this, and you've got like 6 inches of hammer throw, that is not enough. You need to adjust and take out some links out of your spring. You need to check that, make sure you've got proper spring tension there. You need to take some adjustment links out in order to get it more proper. So there you go, about 12 inches of throw, it's hitting very hard. The reason why I say that's adjustable is I can take a few more links out of this. I could raise it up higher. I could lower this down and that'll change the pitch in the hitting angle of the hammer. So all of that is adjustable and tweakable. If you haven't got yours fully set up yet, or you feel like it's hitting kind of weak, you may want to go over those things and check them out. Okay, so let's answer a few criticisms about this hammer, shall we? And these come up a bunch. They're going to come up in forums. They come up on my videos where this hammer is being shown off and that I'm doing things with it. So first and foremost, let's talk about the hit angle. We touched on that already for a short minute, but I want to take and discuss this real quick. So this is not a power hammer. This isn't an inline power hammer, an inline treadle hammer. It's not a mechanical helve hammer. It's not an Ang Yang power hammer. It's not a Big Blue. It's not a Kins Custom Iron hammer. This is a Christ-Centered Ironworks treadle hammer kit with air assist. So what does that mean? The whole principle behind this hammer and the design of this hammer is to create a situation where you always have a striker in your shop. And so, you know, when you need that extra hand to take and wail on something while you're holding some punches or tongs, or you need that extra help to draw material out, that is what this hammer is designed for, is to act as a striker in your shop. It will not take and compete with the big dogs of, you know, $20,000 hammers. That's not what this is for. This is a $700 kit that you can purchase and you can bolt together. Anybody can bolt together in their garage. So that is what this is designed around. So what does that mean? That means that we are adapting a couple different designs and we're smashing them together to make a solution to help that garage smith or that hobbyist smith or that semi-professional smith that wants to have 50 of these hammers at a much cheaper cost than what one Ang Yang power hammer would cost. So that's what this design is for, is to help those folks out. That being said, this is a swing arm hammer. So this swing arm, because it's an air-assisted treadle hammer, it will come down and hit your material like a striker would hit your material or hit your top tooling. Just like a striker, we can adjust our hit angle as we're striking to hit more squarely on our tool or to take and give it more angle or tilt depending on what's needed to match tapers and things like that. How do we do that? We do that by adjusting the hammer to fit appropriately the work that we are doing. So enough droning on about that. That is what this is. It's not an inline and it doesn't cost 10 grand. So again, there will be some movement on it. It will swing like having a striker in your shop. Is that a bad thing? Is that a bad thing to have an angle? A hammer hitting at somewhat of an angle if you didn't adjust it out. Not really. It's not as big of a deal as most people make it out to be. Let's answer another criticism that oftentimes comes up. The other criticism that comes up is the hitting capacity of this. Things get said a lot is, I could take and forge faster, or I could hit harder than that hammer. And the simple fact of the matter is, no, you can't. No, you can't. This is swinging a 10-pound, I believe it's a 10-pound, I might have said wrong. No, 12-pound. This is swinging a 12-pound sledgehammer on a 30-inch handle, and it is swinging that thing with the air cylinder at 140 PSI pulling it down, or the kick of your leg pulling it down. Your arms are not going to be able to generate the same amount of power as what this will be able to output. Now, will it move as fast and rapidly as you could do with a smaller hammer? No, it's not. It doesn't have as fast a cycle rate as you may be able to put out, but guess what? It has a lot more longevity than you do. This hammer is really greatly designed for those that need access to a power tool but don't have access to 9 grand or 4 grand or 5 grand as a starting out point. This is a great option for those people. By all means, knock yourself out. If you can swing a 12-pound sledgehammer by yourself while holding top tools between your legs and glowing bars of steel on your anvil, go ahead and knock yourself out on that. Next criticism that comes up is the design around being able to be connected to a singular 2x4 post. So the point of the 2x4 construction, as it being its mounting point, is a 2x4 is pretty universal. You can get them anywhere, and that's a standard dimensional lumber 2x4. You'll find them in the wall studs of your own home. You can find 2x4s. Now, is that perfectly adequate as in the bracing? As you can see, I don't have 2x4 studded walls anywhere in my shop. Again, keep in mind this was designed around a garage for somebody doing this in their garage. I don't have anything like that, so I had to sink a 6x6 post to mount my 2x4 construction to. And in my video, in my putting all this together, I go in depth and explain about my logic and my upgrades to that and what I think about that to rigid everything up. Is a 2x4 sufficient to take and handle all the strains and the loads and side to side, back and forth? No, it's not. It would be better to take and have a 6x6 or a 10x10 or a 12x12, but then the design would have to become a lot more complex to accommodate those bigger lumbers, and it may not be available in every area. So it is a lot easier to create a situation where all you have to do is hook all your stuff up, streamline to one 2x4, and then you attach that 2x4 to something else to give it the additional rigidity that it would need. So again, it's a valid concern. It's a valid criticism. If this was just a 2x4 sticking out there in the middle of nowhere, of course it would not be enough for this hammer, but that wasn't the intention with the build in the first place. This is meant to be attached somewhere to something rigided with at least 2 to 3 points of contact. So again, the 2x4, it's a valid concern. It's a valid criticism. But it's also something that everybody can get their hands on, and it's something that you can very easily brace for the work that is at hand. So now I'm going to address one more criticism that normally comes up anytime you design and build anything. And I've been dealing with criticisms like this across the entire 6 or 7 years now that I've been on the platform of YouTube with any of my designs in the past. And the basic criticism goes, and you guys have probably already heard it already, is I could take and make that thing for $100. You're gouging people. It's too expensive. It's crazy. What are you doing, right? You're going to hear that, and that's perfectly okay. I mostly ignore those people, and you should too as well. I challenge any of you right now to send me a list of bills and materials to build these hammers for $100 each. Everything you see here, part of my kit. I challenge each and every last one of you right now to go ahead and send me an exact checkout total, an exact cart total, all your costs of plates and materials for $100, and I will buy every last one of them from you. And I will turn around and I will sell them for $700. Because simply put, that's spoken in error. There are certain things in life that you can't get around. You can't just junk it together. You can't get around by just buying scrap material and sticking it together with chicken wire and bubble gum. That's just not how it works. This is a quality tool that I have engineered, I have spec'd, I have built, I have plasma cut out, I've spent sweat equity in to build for you, to take out all the guesswork to where you can just bolt it together in your own shop. Sure, can you make some janky contraption that does the same thing? Yeah, you could. But dare I say, with the steel prices being up over 400%, I guarantee you, you can't make it for $100. So for those of you that are considering the hammer, or you've seen guys post that about the hammers, don't listen to them. Don't listen to them. If you don't want to buy this hammer and you want to save your money up for something else, maybe you can get a sweet deal on a little giant, or you know, maybe you've got enough cash like that, you can go buy an Ang Yang or a Big Blue or a Ken's Custom Iron hammer, please, by all means, go ahead and do that if that's what you truly would like to have. This is an entry-level hammer kit that is all set up by you in your garage. It'll take about, I really don't think it'll take over 45 minutes to an hour to set this up once you have all the pieces. We send everything with it, all the bolts, all the hardware, all the springs, all the chains, all the air cylinder stuff. If you buy the air upgrade, all of that comes pre-wired, pre-assembled, ready to go. All you have to do is bolt it together with your hammer and install it in your situation, and you're up and running. And all that comes to you $700 shipped anywhere here in the United States of America. So I dare you to find a better deal. Alrighty, so there you go. Hopefully that will help answer some of the questions, address some of the concerns about these hammers, and even speak to a few of the detractors. And I hope this will help you make a more informed decision on whether this hammer is right for you or not. For anybody who buys one of these kits from me, one of these Treadle hammer kits here, we are a small business here. It's me, and now working with Thomas. Some of you guys know him as the Glorious Hand Model here on YouTube. I've been working with him, and you know, we've been busting hump trying to make good quality products and tools and things out there for the blacksmith that we sell over at blacksmithingblanks.com. And we're doing our best with that. And again, we're a small company. What do you get with that small company? If you have problems with this hammer, say you buy one and there's something that you need and it's out of adjustment and you need help with that, come to us here at Christ-Centered Ironworks and we will take care of you. We are just one contact form away on our website to getting some help and getting some answers that you need when it comes to actually setting these things up. So please don't hesitate to take and get with us. The worst thing you can do for yourself is go into blacksmith forums, open public forums, and ask questions about something that most guys don't even have in their shop. They weren't part of the engineering process. They don't even know how to build it, nor would they know the first step in how to even create this particular hammer. So that is the worst place you can go for advice, because you're just going to get advice where, what is better, red or blue? It is that broad of a question. Well, what do you think about this? How would you set this up? You're going to have people that have the whole gamut. Well, those hammers suck, don't get them, or whatever. And they don't have one in their shop, nor have they ever purchased one. And so they can't give you a good, honest review. It's kind of like Yelp. I can take and put a review on any old place on Yelp. Easy peasy. Don't even ever have to go there. I can just write whatever review I'd like. That's the internet that we live in. So consider your sources. Come directly to us. We'll take care of you. That's all I've got to say about that. So without further ado, thank you all so much for watching this video. Thank you to the channel members that make videos like this possible here on YouTube. Thank you to everyone who has purchased one of these Treadle hammer kits. And if you have and you've completed a build and that thing's just slamming, that thing's just slamming hot steel and you're making fun projects with it, share it around. I would like to sell a lot more of these. I would like to get a lot more of these out into different guys' shops that haven't seen it yet and haven't heard about it and that, you know, would actually benefit from it. So please share it around. Greatly appreciate it. And again, thank you everyone who has been purchasing blanks from us. Me, Thomas, Jess, my whole family, greatly appreciates it. So that's it for today. God bless, and we'll catch you on the next one. Thanks for watching.